you is something that I think we've seen before. It's a familiar story from Luke chapter 5, Matthew chapter 8. The worst thing that's ever happened in your life could very well be the best thing that's ever happened in your life.
A man with leprosy came and knelt before him and said,
Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean.
Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man.
I am willing.
He said,
be clean.
Immediately he was cured of his leprosy. Said to him,
see that you don't tell anyone, but go show yourself to the priest and offer the gift Moses commanded as a testimony to them.
The worst thing that's ever happened in your life could very well be the best thing that's ever happened to you if it brings you closer to Jesus. God knows exactly who you are. He knows exactly where you are. He knows exactly what's happening to you moment by moment, minute by minute. God knows. While Jesus was in one of the towns, a man came along who was covered with leprosy. When he saw Jesus, he fell with his face to the ground and he begged him, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. One parallel passage says that Jesus was indignant. Some say that Jesus was filled with compassion. Which is it? Depending on which Bible you read, was he happy or was he mad? Was he filled with compassion or was he filled with... It's possible that Jesus was just really hurt, that he would ask, well, if you want to heal me, if you want to make me better, I don't think it's that simple. I don't think Jesus was filled with indignation because the guy asked a question that was not presumptuous. I think that was pretty cool of the guy to not assume anything. Lord, if you're willing, you can make me clean. Jesus reached out his hand and he touched the man. I am willing. And he said, be clean. And immediately the leprosy left him. Then Jesus ordered, don't tell anyone, but go show yourself to the priest and offer the sacrifices that Moses commanded for your cleansing as a testimony to them. Verse 15, yet all the news about Jesus spread all the more so that the crowds of people came to hear him and to be healed of their sicknesses. 16, but Jesus often withdrew. You find from other passages, he often tried to withdraw to lonely places, off by himself so that he could pray. Sometimes the very worst thing that's happened to you could be the very best thing if it actually draws you closer and closer to the Lord. I know it may sound a little insensitive for me to say, but it's really okay that everything's not so okay in our lives. You know, it sounds a little, we'll see. You know, what a big heart you have, Pastor Tony. But it's really okay that everything is not so okay in our lives. Jesus can bless and build anywhere in our lives, can't he? He knows how to find you. He knows what you need. He knows how much cash you need. He knows how much healing and health you need. He knows how much encouragement you need. Jesus can bless you and he can build you anywhere in your life. But we're not usually more aware of the things that are okay. We're usually more aware of the things that are not so okay, aren't we? The places in our life where we're really focusing generally don't tend to be the places of blessing. Unless you win the lottery, and then you're going to owe the government taxes in a couple of years. You'll be in jail. Half your family will hate you. The other half will be dead. Read the stories. It's pretty sad. We're usually more aware of the not-so-okay places in our lives. Huh? Look for the Lord to do things in your life. Look for the Lord to work in the weak places of your life. You know, the chain is no stronger than its what? Weakest link. Satan's not stupid. Satan knows he can't stop you. Satan knows he cannot keep you from getting saved, and he can't keep you from serving. But I can be filled with enough doubt. I can be filled with enough discouragement. I can be disillusioned. I can be so disheartened. Guess who decides to quit? He doesn't stop me, and he can't stop you. Satan can't stop you. If you've already given your life and heart to Jesus Christ, you belong to him. If you haven't given your life to the Lord, well, give your life to the Lord. I'm not trying to make you a Baptist. I'm not trying to get everybody in the hot tub. Well, I am. That sounded creepy, didn't it? I'm not trying to get everybody baptized. I want you to be baptized. But I'm more concerned that you be born again, right? I'm more concerned that you give your life to Jesus, that you give your life to the Lord. Because it doesn't matter how successful you are. It doesn't matter how satisfied you are. If you haven't given your life to Jesus, you're still not saved. And again, my rules are not coming out of my head and my heart, although I believe everything I'm telling you. They're coming out of this. You need to get saved, and you need to get soaked. You need to get baptized, but not to get your sins forgiven. You need to get baptized because it's part of being obedient to the Lord, right? The strongest part of your life is really no stronger than the weakest part of your life. If you're successful but you're not saved, Mark asked, Jesus asked, in the Gospel of Mark, for what shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world but loses his own soul? Right? You need to get saved. You need to give your life to Jesus. But once you're saved, you want to follow him in obedience. Because even if you're saved, the whole point of being saved is to serve him. The whole point of being saved is not just to have fire insurance so you don't go to hell. Praise the Lord for that. But that Jesus saved you and didn't kill you and take you to heaven right away means something. That he saved you and is keeping you means he wants you to live for him. That's what this says. But the strongest part of your life is no stronger than the weakest part of your life. If Satan has been attacking you, and again, forgive me for sounding like a Pentecostal charismatic preacher, if the devil's been after you, but if the devil's been after you, if it looks like there's been this spiritual battle going on, well, maybe there's a spiritual battle going on. And if you sense a little relief right now, don't put your sword down. Don't put down your pistolas because he's coming back again. If this is a satanic attack, if this is a spiritual battle, he's not through because you're still breathing. If he can keep you disillusioned, if he can keep you disheartened, if he can keep you discouraged, if he can keep you whatever it is, whatever D word it takes to keep you at the place where you decide it's just not worth serving him anymore, that's the weakest place in your life. And the most horrible thing that's ever happened to you just might be the best thing that's ever happened to you if it helps you find Jesus right there. Watch this next video. Weak places in our lives.
And I know you guys get tired of me. It's little things.
Coach Peter Morales of the Coronado High School Thunderbirds in El Paso, Texas, makes no qualms about it. He has a favorite on this team.
Mitchell, I need you. I need you to help me out with my coaching tips, Mitchell.
Team manager Mitchell Marcus has a developmental disability.
1, 2, 3,
but he far surpasses everyone here when it comes to love of the game.
He's just an amazing person that our basketball team loves being around.
Yay!
Mitchell's mom, Amy, says he's always been that way.
Mitchell always had a basketball. That was always what he wanted for his birthday.
And because basketball is that important to him, on the last game of the regular season, the coach told Mitchell to suit up.
What was it like to put on the uniform?
I was very happy.
I imagine you were.
Just wearing a jersey was enough for Mitchell. But what he didn't know, what no one knew at the time, was that the coach planned to play him at the end, no matter what the score.
You were prepared to lose that game?
For his moment, yes. For his moment in time, yes.
And so, with a minute and a half left, Coronado leading, but only by 10, Coach Morales put in his manager.
And just started hearing Mitchell, Mitchell.
Mitchell, Mitchell.
But here's where the fairy tale fell apart. Although his teammates did everything they could to get Mitchell a basket, each time they passed him the ball, he either missed the shot or, like on their last possession, booted it out of bounds, turning the ball over to the other team with just seconds left.
He wasn't going to be able to score, but I was hoping that he was happy that he was just put in the game.
Could you have ever imagined what happened next?
No, I did. I could not. Not at all.
What happened next happened on the inbound. The guy with the ball there is a senior at Franklin High School. Number 22, Jonathan Montañez.
The other team.
I was raised to treat others how you want to be treated. Mitchell deserved his chance, deserved his opportunity.
I think I'll cry about it for the rest of my life.
What Jonathan did was yell out Mitchell's name, then threw the ball right to him, right there. One of the most memorable turnovers of all time. It wasn't the game-winning shot. When the buzzer sounded, Coronado had 15 more points than Franklin. But Jonathan's assist and Mitchell's basket did change the outcome decidedly. Play any game with this much sportsmanship. Both teams win. Steve Hartman on the road in El Paso, Texas.
Listen, a weak place in your life may very well be the place where God wants you to win. The very weakest place in your life right now may very well be where Jesus wants you to hit that big win. So look for the Lord to work in the weak places of your life. I promise Jesus will hear you. I mean, it's kind of preacher talk, and you've read that in the Bible, I'm sure. But Jesus will hear you. Matthew 8:1, when Jesus came down from the mountainside, this is just after the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus, where am I? 5:8:1. Am I even in the right church today? Oh, there I am. When Jesus came down from the mountainside, large crowds followed him. Ask around. Luke 5, when Jesus was in one of the towns. So this is a parallel passage. Okay, Matthew 8, there we are in 5. Okay. While Jesus was in one of the towns, a man came along who was covered with leprosy. When he saw Jesus, he fell with his face to the ground and begged him, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." Stop. In the weakest place in your life, Jesus will hear you. He really wants you to find him. God is not the cosmic Easter bunny hiding his will from you. Oh, you're getting cold. Oh, you're getting warm. You're getting warm. Oh, you're getting cold. And if that's not bad enough, God is not playing hide-and-go-seek with you. God is not hiding from you. God is not hiding his will, and he's not hiding his way, and he's not hiding himself from you. He wants you to find him. Do you ever play hide-and-go-seek with your little kids? You can't find Grandpa in the closet. I'm kicking the door from the inside. Hurry, find me. I can't breathe in here. You can't find Grandpa in the closet. Kicking the door. Sticking my toes out from under the closet door. You can't find Grandpa in the closet. Yeah, that's God. And we're kind of doofy, saffy-daffy like that. He's not trying to hide from you. God's will is not hidden. It's right here. God wants you to find him in the weakest place of your life. He knows. I'm not saying don't pray that God heal it, God fix it, God take it away, God make it strong, and then you won't have to focus there anymore. I mean, I pray the same prayers. I've been known to touch the TV screen on occasion. I've been so desperate. I know to pray for stuff. I'm just telling you, don't lose sight of the fact that the very weakest place in your life might very well be the place where he wants to work. He will hear you. He really wants you to find him. Two, Jesus will not only hear you, Jesus will help you. Luke 5:13, Jesus reached out his hand and he touched the man. This was a big no-no. This guy had leprosy. According to Mark, he had bad leprosy. This wasn't just a skin condition. This guy was in bad shape. And there was a good reason that people in that day with leprosy were actually segregated from the community. They were quarantined. They weren't allowed to get with anybody. They didn't understand a lot of the skin diseases, the different kinds of leprosy. The kinds of leprosy that were incredibly highly contagious, well, they were incredibly highly contagious, and they were told stay away from everybody. They had to wear a sign around their neck or at least shout loudly, unclean, unclean, stay away. No one could touch them. No one could come close. They couldn't come close to anyone else. They couldn't touch anyone else. They couldn't live with their family. It was a horrible, horrible existence. That Jesus not only heard the man, but touched the man. I wonder how many years it had been since anyone had hugged him, since anyone had given this guy a high five. I wonder how long it had been since he had held his grandkids or kissed his wife. Unclean, unclean. Jesus reached out his hand and he touched the man. The man had said, "Lord, if you're willing, if you want to heal me, you can." Of course he wants to heal you. Of course he wants to hear you. Of course he wants to help you. So why doesn't he? Of course he knows how much money you need. Of course he knows how discouraged you are. Of course he knows how hard your situation is. So why doesn't he fix it? Why doesn't he fix it? Well, my answer is I don't know. But I would counsel you to look at that weak place in your life and don't overlook that possibility that he wants to work there. Not necessarily to fix it, but to bring you closer to him. Because that's the name of the game. It's not your comfort. It's your conformity to Christ. It's not how happy you are, but how holy you are becoming. In the weakest part of your life, Jesus wants to help you. He not only wants you to find him, he wants you to feel him. He wants you to know the touch of the Lord, whatever that is. Not some spooky, ooh, who is that? But that sense that Pastor Tony doesn't understand, man, I was alone with the Lord, and it was like God spoke to me audibly, and it was like he put his arms around me, and I'll roll my eyes and say, oh, see. But you'll know. You'll know. There'll be a peace that passes understanding, a peace that transcends the fix for your problem. I mean, maybe the problem won't be gone, but right then you get it. You understand that even though he hasn't made it go away, he kissed the boo-boo, but the boo-boo still hurts. He knows, and he can fix it. Just trust him. He wants you to find him, and he wants you to feel him. Jesus will not only hear you and help you, but Jesus will hold you. Chapter 5, verse 13. Jesus reached out his hand. He touched the man. He said, I am willing. He said, be clean. And immediately the leprosy left him. 14. Then Jesus ordered the man, don't tell anyone, but go show yourself to the priest. Offer the sacrifices that Moses commanded for your cleansing as a testimony to them. Mark 1:45 says that instead, he went out and began to talk freely, spreading the news. What did Jesus told him? Don't tell. And what did he do? He did tell. Don't tell anybody. So he responded with telling everybody. Now that seems like a good thing, doesn't it? I mean, share your testimony, brother. God did a work in your heart. Spread it around. Tell the people. Amen. It sounds like a good thing. Unless he says don't. I don't know why Jesus said don't. I mean, you know, I read commentators. They say, well, it made it difficult for Jesus to preach in the outer regions. That made it difficult for Jesus to preach in the other cities. It was difficult for Jesus to preach anywhere because he was Jesus. Maybe sometimes he asks us to do something just to see if we'll do it. I mean, do you think he knows whether we're going to do it or not? You think when God called out for Adam in the garden, Adam, where are you? You think God knew where Adam was hiding? You think he knew which bush? You think he needed Adam to go shake it in the bush for God to know which bush? I don't think so. When God calls out, Adam, where are you? It's not so he can find out where you are. It's so you can find out where you are. I wonder if maybe sometimes God lets us kind of wrestle with stuff and deal with stuff. Maybe sometimes he asks you to do something or asks you not to do something. Not so that he can figure out what you'll do, but so that you can figure out what you'll do. Because he wants you to become more like Jesus Christ. And sometimes that means stopping. Sometimes it means starting. Sometimes it means stopping and starting. Sometimes it means start and stop. I don't know. But you want to please him. It's not a matter of doing what the preacher says. It's not a matter of just following the rules of your church or denomination. It's a matter of doing what he says. Instead, he went out and began to talk freely, spreading the news. As a result, Jesus could no longer enter a town openly, but stayed outside in the lonely places. Well, God said it, so I guess I better believe it. I don't care what the commentators say. That's why, huh? Luke 5:15, yet the news about Jesus spread all the more, so that the crowds of people came to hear him and to be healed of their sicknesses. In the weakest places of your life, Jesus can hear you. In the weakest places of your life, Jesus can help you. In the weakest places of your life, Jesus will hold you. He really wants you to find him. He really does. He's not hiding from you. He really wants you to find him. And he really wants you to feel him. And Jesus really wants you to follow him. He really, really does. Follow me, Jesus said. He called the disciples to watch him. He called the disciples to come see, come follow, come and do. Discipleship is really pretty easy. You know the Lord, you start living for the Lord, all right? You invite somebody to watch you. You invite them to help you. You let them do it and you help them. And then you watch them. You do, they watch. You do, they help. They do, you help. They do, you watch. You go to the next disciple and let them start the process all over again. You're with somebody, they watch you, they help you, then you help them, then you watch them, and then they can do it with someone else. Jesus really wants you to follow him. Give your life to Jesus. Start living for Jesus. Live for Jesus. Live for Jesus. Live for Jesus. At your weakest point, Jesus really wants to hear us, heal us, hold us. I said it a while ago. It sounds insensitive. It doesn't sound any better now. It's really okay that everything is not so okay. Because it's at that place in your life, Jesus can still build you. He can still bless you. He wants you to recognize that there's more to this life. There's more to this life than your job. There's more to this life than coming to church. I love it. I love that you're here. I love that you're here. I love that you come, and I love that you look for ways to connect. I love that you're involved in Beyond the Wall ministry. You're giving above and beyond your regular giving. I like that every once in a while some of you bring waters, and some of you check out the beverage thing, and, oh, they drink Cokes and Pepsis here, and you bring a 12-pack, or you'll bring Cokes, or you'll bring stuff. I mean, that's part of it. Some of you are helping in the cooking area. Some of you show up to do weeds, just kind of every once in a while. Some come regularly to do things. I appreciate that. I love that. But I want you to know that the name of the game is not to get you connected here. I love when you're connected here. Come and connect. But that just gives us an excuse to encourage each other to come closer to Jesus and become more like Jesus. Because someday this building is gone. Someday we're going to be gone. But Jesus Christ and his church, which I hope you're part of, I don't mean this church, I mean his church, the body of called out believers, the group of people who have been saved through the blood of Jesus Christ, I hope that's you. We will live forever and forever and forever with him. And you'll get to stand before him. And I hope you hear him say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And I hope you get to turn around and give me a thumbs up, and I get to go. Because if you stand before the Lord and the Lord says to you, "What were you thinking?" You're going to turn around and look at me and go, "What were you thinking?" And I'm going to go, I don't know. Because I have the high and holy calling of protecting you and positioning you. I have the high and holy calling of feeding you and leading you. It's okay that everything's not so okay in our lives, as long as it keeps us moving closer and closer and closer to him. Look for the Lord to work in the weak places of your life. What are the first steps? Well, have you given your life to the Lord? It's kind of cool that at the first service this morning, someone walked up to me and said, "Okay, I think I'm ready." She handed me a blue book. I said, "Okay, what does this mean? What does this mean? Does this mean you want to get baptized? Does this mean you gave your life to the Lord?" I said, "Well, I thought you'd been saved for a long time. When did you give your life to the Lord?" Because I ask everybody the same questions. When you bring me your blue book, I'm going to ask you the same questions. I thought, "When did you give your life to the Lord?" She said, "Well, I thought a long time ago." She said, "But really it was here in this church. I prayed and I gave my life to the Lord." And I said, "Okay, so you took the blue book home." I asked everybody the same question. "And you read through it and you got it. You understood, no questions?" "No, no, no." "And you got to the back and you prayed the prayer just to nail it down?" She said, "Yeah, I did." "And you signed it?" I'm looking at her signature. "And you signed on the dotted line?" She said, "Yeah, I did." You've given your life to Jesus Christ. You believe he's the only way to have your sins forgiven and to be saved and to go to heaven. She said, "Yeah." "So the blue book means that I got saved and I want to be baptized," she said. "That's pretty cool, huh? That's why I live and breathe." Not so much for the blue books. The blue book is just kind of a, hey, that's cool. But to see people saved, to see people nail it down, to see people want to follow the Lord in obedience and baptism, and to see people want to get serious about their faith. That's what you guys are doing when you come, I hope. You know, the church is a body of believers. Saved people. When you look in the Bible, you look at a church is a body, a group of saved people. I could just as easily say the Southwest Church is a body of believers dedicated to the task of building believers. That means we're here to encourage each other, to help you become more and more like Jesus Christ. I hope you have a good time when you're here, but it's really not about relationships. It's not about feeling happy and having a good time. I hope you're happy when you come, and I hope you have a good time, and I hope you enjoy the other people, and I hope they enjoy you. I hope you have great times of fellowship, glory, hallelujah. I do. But it's really not about relationships. It's really about getting saved. We are a body of believers dedicated to the task of building believers. If your presence here is encouraging somebody else to become more like Jesus Christ, holy high five to you, man. That was a thumbs up. That's a good thing. because that's why you're here. That's why it's cool that we have the cafe. Not to eat, but so that you can sit with people and get to know them and encourage them. I don't care if you eat. Go home and eat. I like that you eat. Not, well, that's one bunch of groceries we don't have to buy for this week. That's not why we do this. We do this so you can hang out with each other, so you can talk to each other, so you can get to know each other, so you can pray for each other during the week. You don't have to ask, well, what problems are you having this week? The pastor said I'm supposed to minister to you. Pass the salt. What are you're a sinner. Okay, let's eat. Go get me a Coke on the way. Yeah, enjoy the time together. I hope that the food's always great and we have a great time getting together. But it really is to be able to build each other up. The Southwest Church is a body of believers dedicated to the task of building believers. So what? So we don't go to heaven and be happy? No. To carry out the Great Commission. The Southwest Church is a body of believers dedicated to the task of building believers for the purpose of carrying out the Great Commission. That's why we're here. That's what we do. That's why I work so hard. That's why I pray for you. Work so hard. I mean, that's why I do what I do. It sounded so... That's not what I meant. That's why I spend all of my waking hours and evidently some of my not awake hours. So I haven't been known to preach while I was sleeping to you, I guess. I'm not sure, but every moment of my day is to help you come to Jesus and to help you become more like Jesus. That's what Lauren and I do. That's why the medical office. That's why Archie's Bar. That's why we do what we do. I want to help you come closer to Jesus. I want to help you come closer to Jesus. If I haven't told you yet, I want to help you come closer to Jesus. The first step is make sure you get saved. The next step, follow the Lord in baptism. Follow the Lord in obedience. Third step is exactly what you're doing. You come and you get the Bible into you, and then you let the Bible out of you. You let the Lord in, and then you let that life out. Go live for Jesus out there. Go live that Jesus life. Don't let the world overwhelm you. Don't let me overwhelm you. Don't let the world overwhelm you. Don't let the flesh overwhelm you. Don't let your circumstances, your situations, don't let your health, don't let your finances, don't let your anybody overwhelm you. That was for husbands is when I pointed to me. Your wives, don't let your neighbor, don't let your any situation overwhelm you, because Satan can't stop you. But he can throw up enough doubt, enough discouragement. You get disillusioned. You get disheartened. And who decides to stop? You do. Get saved. Get soaked. Get serious. I promise. When you find a little relief from this weak time in your life, guess who's going to show up again when you drop your guard? He's going to hit you again. Because whatever it takes to keep you from getting saved, whatever it takes to keep you from serving the Lord, it's not going to stop. As long as you're breathing, it's not going to stop. So don't you stop. You stand. And if you see someone around you with weak hands, the Bible says, lift those heavy hands. How do you do that? Lift their heavy hearts. As much as you can. As much as you can. And if they don't let you get close, then you pray like crazy. Yeah. God, we're praying like crazy. I believe we are a body of believers dedicated to the task of building believers for the purpose of carrying out the Great Commission. God, please don't let any person, don't let anything, don't let any problem stop anyone in our family from standing for you and trusting you and believing in you and wanting to live for you. God, thank you for stories like this man who was healed from leprosy. God, we have needs too. We want to be touched as well. We need to be healed as well. So Jesus, we come to you, knowing that you'll hear us, knowing that you'll help us. God, please change us. We love you. We're grateful that you loved us first. Help us go from this place more encouraged to stand for you, more resolute in our determination to not let anything pull us away from you. God, help us be wise. Help us be diligent. You told us in the Word to be sober. Open-minded, recognizing that Satan is like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Jesus, don't let him get us. Help us stand in you. In your name we pray. Everybody said, amen. God bless you guys. Hang around for a while if you can.
to